Our conference. I'm excited. Our first panel today is themed around family matters. So we have Kai Doofy, who is going to be giving us a great literary analysis paper dealing with Alison Bechdel's Fun Home. First up is Sarah Cash, who's going to be showing us, I think, her video. It has to do with, what would you say, marriage, nuclear family?
Yeah, something along those lines.
And we hope that we will have Kim Gallegos, who will talk to us about the zero tolerance policy and how that's impacted her family since her daughter entered kindergarten. And with that, I will hand it over to Sarah Cash.
So do I need this? I'm probably not going to move a lot. Okay, great. Let me get started then.
Actually, why don't you turn it off?
Okay. Oh no. Uh-oh. Okay, well that didn't work.
Sure. There was, your slide advance?
No, there was a song on here. But that's okay. It was mostly just for so that I would get myself together. But that's okay. So today I'm sharing a video about marriage that I made a year ago. The reason I chose this topic was because my boyfriend and I have been dating for 3.5 years now, and about a year ago, everyone started asking, you know, oh, so when are you getting married? When are you getting married? When are you getting married? You guys have been together for a long time, and it seemed like we couldn't go anywhere without this coming up, and that was fine. Except every time it happened, I freaked out really, really bad. I just wanted to run for the door and hide somewhere. And that wasn't even so much the problem. But I knew that that was hurting Ryan because, you know, he saw this like terror that I would get into just at the idea of marriage. And I think he took it more as that I didn't want to be with him. And that wasn't the case. But I didn't really know what it was. I didn't know what my problem was at all. So that was my main focus for writing this paper, was I just wanted to figure out what was going on. Because it didn't seem like there was a real trigger. The most helpful thing that I found was an article called It Won't Change a Thing, The Meanings of Marriage in the Netherlands by Annecy Kortweg. And in this article, her main goal was to understand how the meaning of marriage has changed and how couples today see it. And not married couples, but couples who are dating or people who are single, because that's really what the next marriage is going to be about. She found a survey that asked people, are married people happier than unmarried people? In 1965, only 22% of the population disagreed with the statement. But in 1991, 85% of the population disagreed. So obviously, there's been a vast change in how people see marriage and relationships. She found that there are four meanings that people associate with marriage. They either minimalize the way that they talk about marriage, they use the idea of marriage to confirm the commitment. So they might not actually be getting married, but they'll bring it up constantly. To see, make sure that, you know, you're really in this with me, right? And then the other is the idea that marriage is going to make everything better. That it doesn't matter what's going wrong. As soon as we get married, everything will be happily ever after. And then the last, and the one that I think applies most to me, is the idea that marriage is a jinx. That as soon as you get married, your relationship's gonna fall apart. So it's, in effect, the exact opposite of what we were talking about previously. So what she found, she interviewed 15 people who were all in their 20s and in like stable relationships, but had never been married. And she found that most of them believed that marriage would have no effect on their relationship, that they would continue however they were, living at the time, I guess, and that it was really more of a symbol for other people, that it wasn't really about them. Then there were a few people who did believe that marriage would change things, but more for practical reasons, for, you know, owning a house or having kids. So, and for that, I could kind of understand, especially now, because Ryan and I are trying to get our own place, and we've been talking about how we don't want to rent because it's like throwing money in the garbage. But buying something, you know, who's going to own it? Whose name is it going to be under? Is that going to cause problems? You know, what are we going to do with our money? And it's kind of scary to think that something like this might tear us apart even without marriage. So I want to share a clip that was a TED Talk, and it's called Why 30 is not the new 20, and she kind of talks about this a little bit. No. Really? Oh, bummer. Okay, because it's pretty cool.
So it's not playing. Do you want to escape and?
Yeah, it might.
And you can go straight to YouTube if you want to. Does it look like it's live? I'm not used to embedding, so I don't know how you. It looks like it's just an image.
That sucks. Okay. Well, I might be able to find it.
Do you remember around the time that she starts saying it?
Yeah. Hold on.
Yeah, we've got time. You don't need to rush past it.
Okay. Okay, well, so in this she talks about how everyone has this idea that with people living longer and marriage happening later, that you have essentially a period in your 20s where you don't have to do anything. It's like in a continued adolescence. And yeah, that's probably gonna work better. Type today. Uh-huh. Not. Hopefully, this isn't in Korean.
That person of his urgency and ambition, and absolutely nothing happens. Trivialized what is actually the defining decade of adulthood.
Yeah, it is.
Leonard Bernstein said that to achieve great things, you need a plan and not quite enough time. Isn't that true? So, what do you think happens when you pat a 20-something on the head and you say you have...
Yeah, just waiting for that. Well, hopefully my other things work.
Ten extra years to start your life. Nothing happens. You have robbed that person of his urgency and ambition, and absolutely nothing happens. And then every day, smart, interesting 20-somethings like you, or like your sons and daughters, come into my office and say things like this. I know my boyfriend's no good for me, but this relationship doesn't count. I'm just killing time. Or they say, everybody says as long as I get started on a career by the time I'm 30, I'll be fine. But then it starts to sound like this. My 20s are almost over and I have nothing to show for myself. I had a better resume the day after I graduated from college. And then it starts to sound like this. Dating in my 20s was like musical chairs. Everybody was running around and having fun. But then sometime around 30, it was like the music turned off and everybody started sitting down. I didn't want to be the only one left standing up, so sometimes I think I married my husband because he was the closest chair to me at 30. Where are the 20-somethings here? Do not do that. Okay, now that sounds a little...
So the reason that spoke so much to me was because I feel like that is why a lot of people get married. they're dating someone and they've been dating someone for a long time, and people start asking them a question, you know, when are you getting married? When are you getting married? And they just do it because that's what you do. And that's not a good enough reason for me. And to be honest, I don't know what a good enough reason is. I've looked and I tried to figure it out and I tried to analyze it, and I'm kind of coming to the conclusion that there probably isn't really a good reason for it. And that's scary. That's really kind of horrible. but it's also kind of great. So going back to the ways people look at marriage is, a lot of people use marriage simply as an idea, and they talk about it to figure out who their partner is and if they're actually going to be there for at least a couple more years. And I had never thought of marriage this way. It had always been such a serious topic to me. But my boyfriend had a very different upbringing. And after about a year that we started dating, he started bringing up like, oh yeah, we should get married sometime. And he was very nonchalant about it. And I didn't understand it at all. But the way that Kortwig explains it is that it's fishing in time, of casting a line out 40, 50, or 60 years away and slowly reeling in the future. So there's a short story from this book called Everything is Illuminated by Jonathan Safran Foer. And the short story is called The 120 Marriages of Joseph and Sarah L. And in this story, these two kids get married at the age of like 7. And then they break up because they get an argument about what the stars are. And then 3 days later, they get back together. And this happens over and over and again throughout their whole entire life. And it kind of makes marriage seem like this huge joke, because obviously no one gets married 120 times. That's ridiculous. But I think it's very realistic for how relationships work. Things are bumpy and people drive us crazy, even the ones that we love, especially the ones that we love. So I kind of wanted to share this because I guess if I were to get married, this is how I would want it to look. So let's disregarding whether the beet is a better vegetable than the cabbage, putting aside the problems of being fat-headed and chronically unreasonable, trying to erase the memory of a long-since-expired rosebush that a certain someone was supposed to remember to water when his wife was visiting family in Rovno, accepting the compromise of the way we have been, the way we are, and the way we will likely be. May we live together in unwavering love and good health. And what I find so interesting about that is that they never stop loving each other. And they never stop knowing that they're in love. But that doesn't stop the problems. And it doesn't make them want to be together. So I guess the idea of this is that marriage really isn't the guarantee that it used to be. It really has become more of a symbol. And I think that we need to come to terms with that. Oh, I need to come to terms with that. Because I'm always looking for a sure answer. And there just isn't one. So the ideal relationship, I had a friend who very much thought this way. About a few months, 3 months before I made this video, she got married to a guy that she'd been dating for 6 months. And, you know, every guy that she'd ever dated was her soulmate, and everyone before was just some crazy mistake, and she moved on so fast. I had no idea how she was able to lie to herself like that. But when she got married, you know, she's my best friend, and I didn't want to shoot her down. I didn't want to make her feel bad. So, you know, I tried to smile, I tried to be supportive, but really what was going on in my head sounded a lot more like the scene in Frozen. I don't know if you guys have seen it. But she gets engaged to someone that she met that day, like every other princess. And for the first time in Disney history, they actually point that out. Like, that's crazy. You can't get married to someone you just met. So it's actually one of my favorite movies because of that reason. And it's, yeah. I don't know. I just, there is something touching about the idea of new love and the idea that, you know, when you find someone that you love, it's always going to be better. And it's the same idea of a guarantee, you know, and it's the same idea that I was looking for, the same idea that I was hoping I would find somewhere if I dug deep enough. So I can't really chastise it that much, because I think that's what we're all looking for. That's what we're all hoping for when we interact with anybody. So the last form, which I think applies mostly to me, was that marriage is a jinx. And the reason that I'm pretty sure I know why I feel this way. Both my parents have been married 3 times. My dad's been divorced 3 times. And marriage just never seemed like something permanent. It never seemed like something that was going to last, that was supposed to last. And I have an older sister who's 7 years older than me, so I always looked up to her a lot. And she was experiencing these divorces in a much more mature age. And I can remember as far back as my memory goes, my sister always swore that she was never going to get married because it didn't mean anything. It was just a joke. And then she started dating this guy, and then they were dating for about 4 years. And then people started asking her, oh, when are you going to get married? When are you going to get married? And every time it happened, she literally broke out in hives all over her body. Anytime she thought about marriage, she got so anxious that she had a physical reaction to it. She finally did marry him, and they're very happy, as far as I know. but it's just, it's crazy to think how much these things really do affect us. You know, we like to think that, oh, it's just an idea, or we can separate it, but really it's something that's an integral part of who we are. So the way that Kortweg describes what marriage means to people now is that marriage then becomes a code word for I love you, I want to be with you forever, and I'm scared that I cannot make it happen. So with that in mind, I don't think this is going to work. So we'll try this. Hopefully this works. Uh-oh. Communications are currently set with other applications. Try this. Yay. I was trying to make it a little bit bigger. Oh, or not disappear, preferably.
I met Ryan's heart-splitting smile 2.5 years ago through a haze of Halloween inebriation. For the first few months we dated, I stuffed his humor, his generosity, his brilliance into an emotional jack-in-the-box. Happiness sprang at me sporadically, gaining strength each time I mashed it down. I knew that I loved him. So, when are you two getting married? I'm snatched by the ankle and dipped into a sea of iced jelly, producing an awkward gagging noise I hope will be mistaken as laughter. Love, I understand. It feels like grass between toes in spring at 5 in the morning. Tastes like molten dark chocolate. Smells like fresh mint. Married? I assumed marriage would make sense when I was older. Well, I am older. And while I naively wait to be struck by epiphany, I find my confusion growing exponentially. My parents were divorced when I was very young. If left in the same room, they began to rip at each other's flesh with jackhammer words and Picasso expressions of anger and pain. But that's natural. Get married, have kids, get divorced, lather, rinse, repeat. When I was about 7, it occurred to me that maybe my mom and dad were just bad at marriage. Bad at it in the same way I was bad at spelling. As marriage becomes a more tangible probability, I begin to wonder if marital failure is genetic. A compulsory recipe for fresh-baked Susie Homemaker glazed with subjugated smiles. I want to marry you, Ryan states, just as simply as if he means to say, I want frozen yogurt. The jelly rushes at me again, befuddling my reason, my emotions. Then I see that smile through the gelatinous fog and realize that maybe there's nothing wrong with being a little lost.
Thank you. All right.